You know, it means a lot for us being in Arizona, and it means a lot to us coming down to Rainbow Music and bringing a good friend of ours, part of the big family of Jackson, Chris Broderick, here with us. Because when I was a kid growing up, there was only two places in the state of Arizona where you can get real guitars, real Jacksons. One of them was this tiny little shop in Scottsdale, and the other one was down here at Rainbow. And we used to have to drive 2 hours all the time just to come down here and hang out with all the other guys. So thank you. Give it up for Rainbow Guitar.
I'd like to definitely thank Jackson for having me out here. It's been awesome. They've done a great job with this guitar and every guitar they've ever done. And I want to thank you guys very much. And also, you guys at Rainbow Guitars, thank you. That's awesome.
We're kind of leading into that. A couple of years ago, I actually got a call from you. It was about 3 years ago now?
Yeah.
About 3 years ago. And that's when we first started... That's when we first started talking about doing a signature model with him. All right, and this wasn't an overnight thing. It wasn't like we just said, hey, let's take a soloist and do this color on it and change the pickups. Chris, tell us about the story. Tell them. I was there, but tell them about the story about this unique guitar.
Yeah, Cannela was definitely the first person I talked to about it, and you know, I was talking to a lot of companies at that time, and Cannela was the guy who really made it, you know, made it sound like Jackson was the right place for me to go because they were going to build the guitar that I wanted. You know, there was no compromise. There wasn't, you know, I'd heard from other companies, just grab this guitar and we'll slap your sticker on it or something like that, you know. And they were all about doing exactly what I wanted. So, you know, I met with him and then we started down that road and I met with Mike Shannon, who you guys have known, has built like Randy Rhoads, his V guitar, and he's just such a great builder. I started meeting with him, and the first time I met with him, he had this kind of general cutout of what I was talking about, but he didn't have it exact, and I was like, well, can you take a little bit off that side, can you shave a little bit off of there, and he grabs this huge, like, Dremel, and just starts... I was just like, my jaw was dropping because I thought he was just going to put a hole right through that guitar, you know, and he shaped it so well, like it was, you know, like watching an artist paint when he was working, and so he helped me construct the body shape, and the reason why I went with this body shape was because it's very ergonomic, you know, it sits well. If you notice, the neck holds up, it holds its position, you're not sitting there trying to hold the neck up constantly, you know. And it's also, you know, it's got a lot of tone to it as far as the mahogany and the maple top. It's awesome. I had him reverse the traditional Jackson, was it SLAT, right?
Yeah, the AT headstock.
Yeah, the AT headstock. Had him reverse it and slim it up just a little bit. And, you know, they put some Planet Waves tuners on this because I love them, and I love the fact that they trim the string for you, you know. They make it really easy and effortless to change your strings, which we all got to be practicing, right? We don't want to spend time changing strings. So that's why I really dug that. And then, you know, I wanted to put stainless steel frets on it. That was, no worries, we can do that, you know. And so they did that. I did a 12-inch radius on my fretboard, which I love. I love curvature, you know. I played everything from flat neck classical guitars, which are totally flat, no radius, to violins, which are like, you know, playing on a broomstick. But at any rate, so I went with that, and Jackson also, you know, they stepped out even of their bounds. They went to Floyd Rose and they said, hey, can you make a low pro version of a 7-string tremolo just for Chris's guitar? And they came back and they did, and it's been awesome because I prefer the low pro bridge over the standard. It just stays out of the way, you know. So that's, I mean, so many great features, unique features, and that's not even talking about the pickups or anything like that. These pickups that come in it, custom, they're based off of a DiMarzio deactivator and a PF Pro in the neck. However, I tweaked them a little bit. You know, I was talking with the guys there and told them that I wanted some more frequencies in the mid-range in the fundamental note, and they did that. So these are custom, you can only get them in this guitar. And you can split it, so you've got two single coils. You can also pull the tone knob, and that's actually what engages the tone knob, because I don't use the tone a lot, and I don't want that particular tone knob taking away signal when I'm not using it. I don't know if you guys know if that happens or not, but the more potentiometers you put in line, the less signal you get from your pickups. So when I put that down out of the way, it's not taking away any of the signal from the pickups. And so that's another brilliant feature that I like about this guitar. And then finally a kill switch, just in case you need to get quiet quick.
Now during that time, I mean, this wasn't a quick thing. You know, we went through all this with Mike Shannon. He was sitting there, we were carving on the stuff. We even came down to Scottsdale a couple of times with the shop back there with Donnie Wade and with Mike Shannon. And these are the original guys that built Randy's guitars. All right, these are the original guys that built the stuff for Warren and everybody else out there that's been using Jackson for, 30 years, 32 years now. So Chris, in the traditional Jackson fashion, we brought him in to really do it the only way to do it. This is really what Jackson is all about. An idea brought to the table, no matter how crazy you can think of it. I mean, we have the longest running custom shop in the world. I mean, if you want a guitar that looks like a penis butterfly, we'll make it. Your friends will kick your ass, but that's okay. It's your fault. We'll make it, and it'll play better than anybody else's. This just happens to be really cool and really ergonomic. So there was a couple questions that came about before, and it's the obvious one. When you joined up with Megadeth, I mean, obviously it was after a little bit of a time with a few different lineup changes and stuff like that.
Right.
And when you came in, you really solidified the position of being the lead guitar player in Megadeth.
Well, thanks.
Nope. It's obvious. Come on. Is that not the shit? And when you stepped up, you were that guy. There was no one, didn't have the fill-in look and nothing like that. What was it like to the point of when you auditioned? Tell us the story about how you became that guy for us, man.
Well, it was really quite strange because it was like probably a day or two before Christmas, and all through the house, no phone was ringing. So then, all of a sudden, out of the blue, I get this call, and this guy is like, "Yeah, I represent Dave Mustaine, and I was wondering how you would feel about being the potential next lead guitarist in Megadeth." And I almost thought, I was like, "All right, who's messing with me? Who's playing with my head here?" And so I basically told him, yeah, I was extremely interested, and from there it just kind of took off. It was so quick because I met with Dave the next week, and we just basically got to work. We had less than a month at that time to go out for the 2008 Gigantour.
That's right.
And so it was pretty daunting in its own way because I had 22 songs to learn in less than a month.
Yeah. And that's a lot of different styles, too. You had Chris Poland, you had Marty Friedman,
Great players,
And then to put your own taste to it as well.
Yeah.
Make them yours. Thanks. So, I mean, and that whole time, and you have to understand, I mean, Chris is also a life-changing flamenco player and an acoustic player. So, and when you hear this kind of stuff, and he brings this style into Megadeth, and with the last couple of records that you've been on, has really taken the music into another level of performance. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that you have a big classical background, a big acoustic background. Tell us a little bit about your influences and how you became where you are now stylistically.
Well, it was actually very much like that in a way. It was almost two roads that I was traveling. I picked up the electric guitar first and fell in love with it right away. I knew that's what I wanted to do, but almost within 6 months of starting to take lessons on this, I was like, well, I want to take classical guitar as well. So I started down that path as well, and took it all the way, through a music performance degree at the University of Denver and Lamont School of Music. And then this, I was, constantly taking lessons on and, learning, just like I'm sure a lot of you are, as much as you can, trying to get as much information as you could. And some of my biggest influences were like Jason Becker, Marty Friedman, of course, and Paul Gilbert, who was just phenomenal, and Greg Howe as well, another just monster player. So I love all those guys, and they consumed a lot of my hours as a teenager trying to get their licks down. So, and then on the classical guitar side, real quickly, Paco de Lucía for flamenco, and Elliot Fisk, and
Julian Bream. I mean, you could go on forever in any of these categories.
Yeah. And that's the cool thing about the guitar as well, is that when you split those single coils and put it in the middle position, it sounds so good for finger pick music. So, you know, enough chatting. Why don't you play some music, dude?